for Hot Copy this morning. Our guest today, why should guys have all the fun? That's the question posed by Filipino-American businesswoman Loida Nicholas Lewis in her page-turning memoir that tracks her journey from Sorsogon City to breaking the glass ceiling in corporate America. Don Tagalang has this report.
At 80 years old, Loida Nicholas Lewis says she had so much fun writing her memoir.
Why should guys have all the fun?
In her new book, the immigration attorney turned CEO of a billion-dollar empire, TLC Beatrice, takes readers from her simple upbringing in Sorsogon City in Bicol, Philippines, to becoming a real-life crazy rich Asian in New York City.
Why should guys have all the fun? An Asian-American story of love, marriage, motherhood, and running a billion-dollar business empire.
The book delves into her biracial love story with the iconic Reginald Lewis, the first Black American billion-dollar deal maker, as well as their challenges in raising two mixed-culture daughters.
Really, in the eyes of God, we're all equal. So, for those who are in a multicultural society like New York, accept people as they are, because we are all the same. We belong to the one race, the human race. As President Obama said, we're not black, we're not white, we're not yellow. We are all members of the human race.
After the untimely death of her husband at the age of 50, Nicholas Lewis took on the challenge of becoming the CEO of their multinational corporation, TLC Beatrice International, in a rather tough time of their life.
Well, the most painful really is when Mr. Lewis died. You know, he was the son in which we warm our ambition. And so when the sun disappears, that was like, you know, it was cataclysmic. I couldn't say to our Father, "Thy will be done," until after many months. So that is the most painful part of my life.
In the 90s, a woman of color CEO in a business world dominated by white men is quite rare. Not only did she break the glass ceiling and shatter the notion of how CEOs look and act in corporate white America, she even raked in $2 billion in revenue. Nicholas Lewis says her book is scheduled to be released in time for the National Women's History Month in March.
That's why I wanted it out on March, Women's History Month, is that many women are afraid to take on challenges that comes their way. And this book will tell them, you can do it, guys. You can do it, gals. In other words, don't be afraid of taking on challenges. We can do many things that men can't do.
On top of that, Nicholas Lewis found time to use her platform to support politicians she believes are good for America.
We campaigned hard for President Obama. We campaigned hard when it was Hillary's turn to run for president, but it wasn't her time. And so we campaigned hard for Joe Biden, and Joe Biden won. So I would say we have a winning streak. 2-1.
The most important question is, did Loida Nicholas Lewis have fun living her American dream?
Yes, of course. You know, we have gone every Christmas to the Caribbean. We have lived in Paris, my dream. We have, and of course, who would not have fun when your better half reaches the very top of corporate America? He was on Fortune 400. But the most fun is that I loved Mr. Lewis, and he loved me. So that's the most fun.
Don Tagala, ABS-CBN News, New York.
What a beautiful story. We're now joined by the author of Why Should Guys Have All the Fun? Filipino-American businesswoman Loida Nicholas Lewis is live right now via Zoom, and she is in New York City. Loida, good morning to you and good evening to you.
Thank you. Good morning to you, Karen. And I'm so glad to be invited by you once again.
All right. Now, why did you choose to write this book at this time in your life? You just turned 80 years old, and you could have written it any other year. I mean, you've been through so much. Why is it that you chose this particular year?
Well, I really wanted to have it out when I turned 75 because the Washington Post, Katharine Graham, gave her biography, I mean, published her autobiography when she turned 75. But my 75 came and went and nothing happened. Yeah. Now that I was close to turning to 80, I told the co-writer of my husband's book. You know, my husband was not able to finish his book and wrote this, Why Should White Guys Have All the Fun?
Blair Walker.
That's right. So, you know, Blair Walker wrote this. And for the past 25 years more, I have been going around promoting the book because now not too many people have known that Mr. Lewis was able to crack that hardest of ceiling, buying a $1 billion company on a leveraged buyout, meaning mostly borrowed money, with 64 companies in 31 countries. That was record-breaking, not only for Black Americans, but for America. And after 30 years since he died, I was only chapter 6 in his book, Why Should White Guys Have All the Fun? So I said, I better write my own book so that I will write the prologue before meeting Mr. Lewis. Of course, my 25 years as his wife, and then the epilogue of Mr. Lewis' life when he died. So now I came out with the same title, but different. Why Should Guys Have All the Fun? An Asian American Story of Love, Marriage, Motherhood, and Running a $1 billion Empire.
You know, I was gonna say that that's what's amazing is, well, number one, the fact is you actually really have a genuine love story. You know so many New York stories of wherein a woman marries a very wealthy guy and they divorce after, there's no happily ever after, but you actually had a happily even ever after, even if he passed away, is you were genuinely really in love. And frankly, you weren't just a housewife. Many people may not know, you actually passed the New York bar, right? You were an immigration lawyer, and then you passed the New York bar, I believe, was it on your first try? Did you tell me? So that is a feat in itself. So Mr. Lewis married his equal, so to speak.
Well, I would say he was more than my equal. That's why I fell in love with him. He was more driven, more hardworking, more ambitious than I was. I always tell people, you can see I am a type A. But he was triple A. And most of all, he is the man that will wear the pants in the family. You know, I came from UP College of Law. I have great classmates, great colleagues, but in my mind, I can always henpeck them. So why would I get married, you know, and wear the pants in the family? But when I met Mr. Lewis, surrender. Lloyd has met more than his match.
Yeah. Why do you think, looking back now, what made him really fall in love with you? I mean, clearly you have so many beautiful attributes, but considering this is a very powerful man, very driven, there could have been so many choices. What was it about both of you?
Yeah, when we were getting closer to one another, he told me, he confessed that he wasn't planning to get married until he was 35 years old. He wanted to establish himself first, and then choose a wealthy woman and get married when he was 35. But we were 26 and we were both lawyers. We were both in love. So I proposed to him, actually. It was me who proposed to him, not him.
You and how did I do him?
I proposed to him because, you know, what else? We were both ready. So in my mind, darling, while we were in the subway, darling, do you want a big wedding or a small wedding? A small wedding. He replied. Then I followed up with, where should we have it? NYU, they have a small chapel. And suddenly he realized what was happening. We actually, you know, said we can get married. And so he said, I have a headache.
So stories like this, snippets like this of your own life, this can be read in the book. This is clearly part of the book.
Yes, yes. Many other things are in the book that nobody knows. I thought that it is important for me to tell the entire story, because they see only that, oh, wow, she is, you know, she has a house in East Hampton, a house in Fifth Avenue, a house in Paris. But that's not it. When we started as husband and wife, when we first got married, we lived in a 5-story walk-up without an elevator.
Yeah.
Although I decided, you know, I told my husband, I want to work in a poverty law firm, and I was going to take care of expenses of the house. And since I could not, you know, match our expenses, I have checks this thick on not sufficient funds, meaning I'll write a check for the butcher and the butcher would call me later, Mrs. Lewis, your check bounced. Okay,
yeah, imagine.
Give it to me and I'll give you cash. And supermarket, Mrs. Lewis, your check bounced. Give it to me, I'll pay you cash when my salary comes. So it's not like we were up there. We really, Mr. Lewis and I, climbed, you know, our way to success. And that's what I want to tell, especially women, that we will be challenged and take it up. Don't worry. We are Filipino women. We can do it.
Now, this is so inspiring because you're right. When you say the name Loida Lewis, people think, oh, she's the billionaire Filipina who lives in New York. And they never really go back to just your humble beginnings. And it all really started even in Sorsogon. But clearly you can read that in the book. But I wanted to ask you, so your husband was clearly the most famous billion-dollar deal maker, in a way, during his time. He did break not just the glass ceiling, but that racial ceiling. So that was a harder glass to break during that particular time. But when he passed away, you started to take over the company or run your own company. Can you talk about this?
Because when he passed away, I was a basket case, you know. We were young, you know, he was just 50. We had 2 girls. We were supposed to grow old together. And then after a short illness with a biopsy that he had cancer in December 31, the new year, by January 19, he was dead. You can imagine, it was like, you know, suddenly the sun stopped shining. I was totally, totally discombobulated. But you know, I am so glad I am Catholic, I am Christian, I'm Filipina, because I never lost faith in God. Even if I say, thy will be done, I could not say it, I knew that God will not forsake me, that he will remain, he will not leave me orphan. And the Isaiah proverb, a mother may forget the baby on her breast, and even if she forgets, I will not forget you. I hold you in the palm of my hand. All of those words gave me courage.
And so it is in the book
that when I woke up 6 months later, December 22, the sun was shining in my room. Normally I would get up and open it up, you know, with my hands and tie it down, but that time somebody did it and nobody said that they did it. So but for me it was a sign, Loida, time to open the window, let the sun shine in. And that's the time I told my daughter, Leslie, I'm taking over the business. Mm-hmm. Not that he said, Loida, you do it. No, it's because I will have to be responsible for the family. We were choosing CEOs. Most of them were white. Most of them were asking a lot of money. And I have nothing against that. But nobody could assure me that they will make it successful. So if it fails, what, you know? I'm pointing my finger at them. No, take responsibility for myself and my family. And that's when I said, I'll take over.
Yeah. And what was it like taking over? So you took over TLC Beatrice, right? You took over that, but let's face it, even if you're a smart woman on your own, you're an immigration lawyer, you know, this is a business. What challenges did you face taking over that business?
Well, if it was running successfully, I would not have taken. But in 1993, when he died, a strong leader was gone. Secondly, it was 1993 was the worst recession in Europe since World War II. Number three, half of our business is ice cream in Spain, in Italy, in France, in Germany, in Norway. Mm. And so what happened? Income went down. We could not even meet our payroll in New York. So, and expenses, of course, were very high. We were on the top floor of this 9 West 57th Street. It doesn't need a scientist to understand your income is low. Your expenses is high. What do? Increase income, reduce expenses. So that's the first thing I did. Sell the company plane. Release all the limousines. Wow. Cut my corporate staff into half. And from 30,000 square foot, go down to 10,000 square foot. So in the first year, we immediately had in the black, 1 million net income. And then it continued through the years. And by the second year, we increased our income from 1.5 million to 2.2 million. I mean, it took me 3 years, but that's what happened. So,
But how did you do it, Loida, considering many women could be watching right now and they may be thinking, how did you do that? I don't have business training. Some women may be saying, you know, you took over the business when you were 50. Am I correct? Right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So people could be saying, I don't have training. How could I imagine that second wind or that second life doing something else?
Well, many people don't know. I mean, especially Americans looking at me, they don't know that I am a lawyer in the Philippines at the UP College of Law, that I am, I was able to pass the bar of the United States without studying in the United States in a law school, that I grew up in a family of entrepreneurs. It was not humble. We were one of the upper middle class in Sorsogon. My father was very successful, Nick Fur Furniture. So we were, you know, we had a movie house named after me, Loida Theater, because in my father's plan, I will run for public office. And therefore, when I'm ready to run, I already have public recognition, name recognition. Mm-hmm. So all of that there, you know, I would, growing up, I would hear my father, how much is the shrimp? Yang hipon.
Uh-oh.
And then I will hear him negotiate. So although many women are watching this and they say, how did you do it? Mm-hmm. You know, we have hidden weapons. And even if you don't have a background, use common sense. Yeah. As I said, I was able to see who among these 30 employees I have to let go. Those who did not share my values, those were, you know, medyo naiinggit or envious. So, but I was see to it that they have very huge separation pay. Mm. And for the support staff, the secretaries, I recommended them to the law firm that we were using. So, you know, I was tough, but I was compassionate. I was human, humane.
Oh, did you experience losses when you ran the business and did you share this in the book?
Yes, all of this is in the book. Why should guys have all the fun? I'm saying is that for us women, we can do whatever he can do, we can do not better, but differently and maybe better. Because we are women, we don't have to be a man. We have to keep our own identity and authenticity. But I must say, Filipino women, in the scale of 1 to 10, we are up there in the upper 5% of Filipino women in executive position. So for those who are listening here, who are Filipino women, we are good. We're very good, very entrepreneurial. We have common sense and we're ready to work very hard. I worked hard as a CEO.
Okay. Yes. And I wanted to add here that when you took over TLC Beatrice, overall, it raked in revenues of $2 billion. This is correct. The figures are correct.
Yeah. 2.2.
$2.2 billion.
And in revenues.
In revenues. And where is TLC Beatrice today?
All right. Because there is, when Mr. Lewis took over, he had made a deal with the supermarket business in France. that in 1997, there will be a put and call. That means to say in 1997, the owner of the company, well, the minority owner, because Mr. Lewis, of course, was majority owner, can say put to Mr. Lewis or TLC Beatriz, I want you to buy us out. Okay, so you become 100%. But it is the price would be a multiple of 15. Mr. Lewis also can say, look, I want to buy 100% of the company, multiple of 13. But by 1996, if we wait for that time, because the company in France, Leader Price, was growing by leaps and bounds. So the income was going higher. And if we wait that time, the financial obligation of buying them out will be enormous. So so what did we decide? The you know, everything is comes for a reason. The French government passed the law that no more foreign company can come into the United States, the France, in the supermarket business.
Is meaning that right?
Walmart cannot come in. 7-Eleven cannot come in. And Aldi in Germany cannot come in. So what happened to the price of supermarket in France? Went sky high, 37 multiple. So we said, our multiple is only 15. It's got value. So we sold it to Casino. We sold the supermarket business in France to Casino. And that started this, the liquidation of the company. We had so much money, and we had so much money. We paid down debt, zero debt. By the time I came over, we have zero debt, and we have so much money. And to distribute that as dividends to our shareholders, Uncle Sam says, give me 50%. Are you going to give money to your shareholders with Uncle Sam getting 50%? The only way to distribute this amount of cash is by liquidating. And the income tax is only, capital gains tax is only 20%. So I started selling the company piece by piece. The potato, the first, the supermarket, so we had zero debt. The potato chips company, the ice cream company in Italy. We sold Italy, Spain, all the ice cream company. So in the end, we paid, there's no more debt, and we got back $1 billion.
Amazing. No, and even the strategy you share, the strategy that you did in relation to really the US situation too, because it would be different for each person in every country they lived in, but clearly your strategy was also in a way, how would you do it best considering taxes in the US would be so high?
Yes, I understood the plan of Mr. Lewis, and I was just finishing his work. He said, merger and acquisition is the best way to create wealth. And therefore, in my mind, I was not going to build an empire. It was to create wealth. And so when it was time to sell, sell. I think for any businesswoman, well, businesses, if for any businesses, whether in the Philippines or in the United States, you must always have an exit strategy, okay? Because you will say, no, I will hold on to it until I die. So if that's your, then you have to plan very well for the transition of the company. So, you know, in every company, you must have an exit strategy.
Wow. All right. In your memoir, clearly, there will be learnings. And there will be advice or guidance that you would like the audience, the readers, to take from you. And other than, of course, we're Filipina, we can do it. What would you say was your game changer life lesson?
Well, especially for those who are watching, women and men, spouses, those who have, you know, significant other, I would say, learn to love one another fiercely. Time is so short. And what does that love mean? It's just not one, the language of love, affirmation of words. So when your other partner comes home dejected, disappointed, or said something wrong, you should not say, you're so stupid, why did you do that? Because then you're putting him down. So it should be words of affirmation. No, don't worry, darling. That was the right thing to say. or that was the right thing you did. Do it right. Don't worry about it. So the second one is actions of service. I considered myself the wife, and my husband is out there fighting monsters and dragons. So when he comes home, it's not, you're late again. No. He said, darling, are you hungry? You know, do you want a massage? Okay. Service. I want him to be, you know, to come home to an oasis so he could drink some more. And the next one is attention or listening, quality time. When Mr. Lewis comes home, there is, you know, I serve him the dinner that he wants. It's very simple. I'm not a good cook, but he only wants fried chicken or hamburger steak. And so, or we order out so that he can have whatever he wants. So when he comes home, he would always talk about the day. And I'm an active listener. It's not like he's talking and my mind is already, what will I do tomorrow? Yeah. Or what will I do with the children? No, I listen. I am active listener. And if there is something, you know, that I could say, I say it. But basically, I listen. And, you know, I don't give him gifts. I give him small things like, you know, a written note that, you know, that I love him. And the last thing is that the last thing is I am embodying with me, and it's in the book. When he told me that he had dinner with somebody while he was in New York because we were living in Paris. Oh my God. It's like, you know, jealousy. The green-eyed monster of jealousy was there. So
Loida Lewis gets jealous. I thought only ordinary people like us get jealous. Even you get jealous.
I am human. I am human. So my imagination is, oh my God, he's sleeping with somebody else. And that's when I really incorporated St. Paul's definition of what love. Love is kind. Oh. Loida is kind. Love is patient. Is Loida patient? Love is not proud. Is Loida not proud? Love is not self-seeking. Is Loida seeking everything for herself? Love never fails. Love never ends. Does Loida's love ends just because he's sleeping with somebody? So when I incorporated that in my being, you know what? He can do no wrong. He can do no wrong.
Oh, wow. Now
my love became unconditional. It's not, I love you if you do this, or I love you if I'm the only one. Really, that was it. And because of that, I changed. And he noticed it, he changed. And so our years in Paris are the best years of my life. God's gift to me. Because that he was going to, God was talking to get his life. So, ganun. You know, that's what I want to tell the women, those people who have special people in their lives, love. Ano ba yung kantang yun? How to handle a woman or how to handle anyone?
I don't know. Ang daming kanta about love.
That's a song of King Arthur in Camelot. How to handle a woman is to love her, simply love her, merely love her, love her, love her. See? So that's my book. Why Should Guys Have All the Fun? It's a story of love.
Yes. I was going to say, my gosh, and to think, I haven't even read the book, so I need to get a copy of the book, okay? I mean, first, is that going to be sold in the Philippines? Is that going to be in Fully Booked, National Bookstore?
We're making arrangements. They have not come back to me.
Okay.
So we're making arrangements.
Because do you come to the Philippines for this book and you could have like a small conference? And I feel that it's such, you know what I love about your story, and I love interviewing powerful women on how they succeeded. But what I love about your story is the $1 billion is the bonus. That's the thing about your story. What's really amazing with your story is the true wealth is your love story. You know, not many people experience being with their true love in this one lifetime. So how you kept it, how you valued it, and how you just came off from grief and made something even more of yourself. I think that's where the power is you really just moved from love to love to love in this whole journey.
Yes, yes, yes. Love conquers all, really, honestly. But I'm also talking to women who are being physically maltreated and slapped and hurt. Now, use your head, okay? Yeah. Yeah. If you are being physically maltreated, leave, okay? Mm-hmm. There is no two notes about it. I mean, just use your common sense. If you love this person, but the other person cannot see and respect you as a human being and physically handicaps you, leave. That's not love. He doesn't love you. But for those two people like me, all right, he's not perfect. I mean, the amount of curses, you know, this HSIT and the MF, yes, and then parang umuulan yan. In my mind, he is an African American. He's a black man in America, where bigotry and discrimination and you know, racism is actual. And because he's black, he's treated differently. So when he comes home, you know, and I just say something and then he bursts out. Yeah. Okay, love. Why? Because he has to burst out somewhere. Better na sa bahay. You know, I can handle it. I can handle it because I don't take it personal. It is his way of expressing the anger and the humiliation that he gets out in America.
All right.
Yeah.
No, I mean, we can talk forever, Loida. You know that. But I do hope to see you again. And where can they order your book very quickly? Because we're going to go to break now.
Actually, it's on Amazon.com, except that it's not expensive to mail in the Philippines. So wait, we were making arrangement, maybe fully booked, maybe national bookstore. But and eventually, you know, the books will come. I'm sending 500 copies to my sister, Melly Nicolas.
Okay, and I'm going to get one. I'm going to get one,
Melly. I'm signing one book for you, Karen. Thank you. All right.
Loida, you take care, and thank you for being an inspiration, not just to all women, but specifically also to the Filipino community in the United States. You take care, and more good health. Take care. All right.
Take care.
All right, Loida Nicolas Lewis, Why Should Guys Have All the Fun? That's a good book to read.